Hello, Malty Manx Monks.
Yeah.
And thank you to Pete Smokey for that malt mention introducing a whisky review here at Ralphie.com. Our Ralphie stuff, if you happen to be viewing through my channel on YouTube. And this is Whisky Review 463. And I have in front of me, on the barrel, here in the Manx Bothy, a single Scotch malt whisky, which I'm going to review. I'm going to smell it, taste it, tell you about it, give it a malt mark, and then give you an additional information section thing at the end of this review, because I know how much you appreciate them, but there's something I need to do first before I can do any of the rest of this review. Yeah, it's obvious. I need to pour a glass of whiskey. Here goes. Do, do, do. You'll notice I've not actually tasted that much of this. For a very simple reason. It's been quite small. In fact, I'm going to have to pour some back into the bottle. There we go, that's better. Because I've just done a bottle swap with a friend who says, by the way, I've not tasted Jura before. Could you give me a decent Jura and I'll just do you a bottle swap? And I've said, yeah, well, so long as you have enough to taste over a few days. So I've been tasting this for about 4 days. Jura Superstition. Jura Distillery is on Jura, the Isle of Jura, which lies just north of the island of Islay. And generally, whisky fans tend to lump Jura in with the Islay distilleries. And why not? Because it is a good, robust West Coast whisky, which has a lot in common, really, with Bunahabin, which is one of the nearest distilleries to it. Not overtly peated, but you do increasingly see peated versions, more heavily peated versions of Jura, and at a younger age from independent bottlers, I think they're well worth looking out for. You will normally find that the first in Jura Isle of Jura whisky you encounter in the shops is the 10-year-old. In my opinion, it's a bit too young. It's a little bit too rough. 12 years is really should be the entry level for Jura. But what do I know? Who am I to dictate bottling policy for White and Mackay? It's not going to happen. So back to the real world. If I'm buying a bottle of Jura, if I'm recommending a bottle of Jura, which is affordable and available, this is what I'm recommending. Older versions of Jura are now really very expensive for what they are, as the producer taps into the collectors and ni plus ultra premium deluxe market. I think they call it something like that these days. Basically, whisky for people who have got more money than sense. Initially, I'm getting a nice, rich, brown sugar, slightly toffee nose with a touch of hint of licorice, but quite a touch of, well, toasted peat. Now, this is being advertised as a lightly peated version of Superstition. Previous versions have not had this this accolade, so to speak, in the label. Frankly, I don't think it means very much in this instance as an official bottling because of the chill filtration and the addition of colourant, which is sort of masking the greater complexity of this. But it's still a worthwhile dram. Slight sherry notes here. There's a certain richness in the nose which is suggesting to me that a lot or a high proportion in the batch is first fill cask, by which I mean it's cask which has had a previous content of bourbon or sherry or wine or port, and then without disassembling the casks and re-toasting them and all the rest of it, they've been shipped in intact and with some of the previous content still sloshing around inside, giving that extra kind of fullness of flavour, the spirit's been matured that way. relatively young whisky. There's a youthful bite on the nose, maybe about 8, 9, 10, 11 years. It kind of can be quite hard to say. It's all down to the size and the range and the condition of the casks. Rich honey, some slight hint of citrus, orange citrus. Reminds me of Van der Hoom orange liqueur from South Africa. And raisins, certainly. And a nice little kind of dry wood spicy note in the background. This, incidentally, is bottled at 43%, so a little bit stronger than your average, which certainly helps. Although if you're in America, you'll find that a lot of Scotch whiskies are actually bottled at 43% instead of 40%. You know, the rest of the world gets 40% volume. In the United States, you lucky people, you get that little bit extra because you're an important and discerning market. Well, good for you. Just adding a wee drop of water to this, not much. Before I taste this whiskey, I'm going to mention this. I think it's hilarious, actually. Inside the carton here, it's advertising a free gift tag, right? I'll show you the gift tag. This is... That's your free gift tag. Supply your own string. Talk about tacky, honestly. Premium single malt Scotch whisky. And you get a little push-out cardboard square as your gift tag. Now, if they put in a nice, colourful, decent quality postcard inside, you know, that might be something to keep. But this, frankly, it comes across to me as tacky and cheap. Aha, there's a kind of whiny note coming through here. The nose is opening up. There's some substance to it. Some busyness in terms of flavour. Arrival. Sweet and dry. Brown sugar. Sweetness, bourbon sweetness, sherry sweetness, raisins, slightly scorched raisins. Wood spice, hint of clove, cinnamon, definitely. Oranges, orange marmalade. If you happen to be in Britain, it comes across as Frank Cooper's Oxford marmalade, which is a particularly well-made marmalade, in which you get a kind of fullness of the orange flavour, and you're getting that here. Also getting a hint of walnuts, although it's quite weak and reserved in this particular version, not half as prominent as in even 16, 18-year-old Juras, where it becomes quite an interesting and engaging feature. But this is too young a whisky for it to show clearly. Hangs about in the palate, really nicely. It's lovely. Slightly two-dimensional, but has a fullness of flavour. There is a richness. It would certainly be a good substantial whisky to have with a cigar, for example, if you do that sort of thing. There's a certain rum-like quality, a rum-like richness to this that you get from, say, the Jamaican rums from Ray and Nephew or El Dorado from Guyana. But it's not a complex whisky, but it has a roundness, a decent complexity, and I'm quite liking it. As I've mentioned briefly before in the start of this review, as an available, affordable Jura, I think this about is as good as it gets. I'm going to give this 85 out of 100. There we are. And that's a malt mark. Jura is a strange place to visit, the Isle of Jura. If Most folk tend to go to Islay for a whisky tour and then stop there. But Jura Distillery is well worth a visit. It's got a good team at that distillery. It's a little bit of a kind of old-fashioned character to it for all the right reasons. And, you know, it could be one of Scotland's great distilleries if the cask policy was a little bit more generous, because there's some real, the big stills in Jura, and it's definitely a big, beefy, characterful, old-fashioned sort of fireside malt. And when it's good, really, it can be fantastic. It can be one of the best. I remember tasting an old Jura, which I got actually from a sample bottle in one of the pubs when I lived in Glasgow. And I remember it. You know, there's, I think there's about a dozen whiskies that I really, really, really remember. They've never forgotten. And Isle of Jura was, in fact, one of them. And it was an old sherry, traditional sherry. I think it was a Montelado sherry cask from years and years ago that had just been overlooked. And when it had been emptied, there'd been a little bit left at the bottom, and someone had filled a wee sample bottle. Just, you know, as a favour swap in the ages gone by, when they, you know, it was perfectly acceptable and usual to do that sort of thing. And but I've been on Jura actually many years ago. I did some hiking around Jura, and it's a very much an island detached almost from the rest of Scotland. It's a bit like Harris and Lewis. It's really out there on its own and absolutely covered with red deer, and all of it's privately owned by massive landowners who treat it like a fiefdom. You know, they do. And but you've also got Barnston, which is the cottage up in the north east of Isle of Jura, where George Orwell wrote his novel 1984, which, if you want to be thoroughly depressed, have a read of that. But if you want to be more informed, read Animal Farm by George Orwell. And if you want to be bewitched by his writing, read Homage to Catalonia. Books can be wonderful. It's just picking the right books. But thoroughly enjoying this. It's now, of course, I don't get to taste any more of this. It's now become a bottle swap of an almost full bottle. But there we go. I think that what I'll be getting in return is worth the sacrifice. And it's something for you to consider, is if you have a bottle, occasionally you have a few sips out of it. Let someone else try. Do you like this? Right, let's just do a swap. A bottle of whiskey can be very powerful currency. It can be literally economy in its own right, an economic mechanism which bypasses the Ponzi printed stuff. And that is why the gaugers were responsible for stamping out illicit distillation in the Highlands and all around Scotland back in the early 19th century, many, many years ago, when whisky became legalised, and all the legends they tell you about that. The real reason was nothing to do with tax evasion. The reason was that whisky was a tradable currency, a communally valued currency, and gave fiscal independence. And you don't control people if they control their own money. As simple as that. That's why it was stamped out. Anyway, one final thing before I conclude this little whisky review, which I trust you're enjoying. Yeah, just dropping my props now. I'm going to introduce you to this. You might not have seen it. If you're a regular whisky festival goer, you will know what this is. This is a whisky glass lanyard, and I'm going to demonstrate it for you. All the serious hardcore whisky anoraks who pop up at whisky festivals have these, and they use them as a symbol of their multi-anorakiness. Here we are. What you do is you get your whisky glass, you get the band round the base of the glass, right? And then you get your Velcro bit and you put it round the side of the glass, and then you get the clip and clip it into your lanyard, and you can talk whiskey and you can get your whiskey glass filled up at the stands, and then you can get both hands free to write up your whiskey anorak notes, knowing that your lanyard is keeping your whiskey nice and safe and not spilling. And if you happen to drop your glass, whoops, well, it's not going to smash. It's, I think you can probably buy them on eBay, or if not, try some of the whiskey shops might know where you can buy them. It's a nice little accessory. It's some fun. But if you see people at whiskey festivals with one of these, taking notes about their sampling and about still capacities and how barometric air pressure affects the duration of the heart, from the still, then you know that you are in the presence of a true malt anorak. There we are. I'm Ralphie. I'm a bit of an anorak. I don't use these at whiskey festivals, but if I'm out and about in the garden, having a barbecue or whatever, then I do actually, to save losing the glass in the greenery. Anyway, I shall now lose this video in the greenery of time, because it's concluded, it's finished, the malt mark's given, and it's time for me to go and finish this whisky and arrange for a bottle swap with a friend. Wonderful stuff. And we'll come, if you come back again soon, I'll be reviewing another whisky from an independent bottler, and it will be heavily peated. Right. I'm not going to say any more than that, but I'm sure you'll find it interesting. And that'll be Whisky Review 464. Yep, it's not far away now. See you soon.